In this and in the next tutorial, I will take you step by step to show all the different pins of an I/O box value advanced. This node is one of the most important nodes in VVVV, so let's get started. If you create an I/O box value advanced, double right click, move your mouse away, and you select it and press F1, you will see the help file. In this help file, you'll see all the other looks and uses an I/O box value advanced can have. We got our standard I/O boxes, some booleans, banks and toggles, some sliders. Let's go a bit into the detail on how to use and make these. You need an hair inspector, and I opened one already. In the help patch, you see these different I/O boxes. And these are all the same type of I/O box, but they are changed using hair inspector. At the top, we have our standard I/O boxes. But when I select one, and I look at hair inspector, I can see it is set to input. Now, they are set to input, but yet they have more than one slice. The cool thing is, when I connect a spread to an I/O box, and then delete the spread, the I/O box will remember the last value. This is a very handy feature if you want to test something and need a quick way to fill some I/O boxes with information. So if I make an I/O box, and I put the calls rows count to something different, and I scale her up, you see by default I only have one value. Now if I make a linear spread, and I connect this to the I/O box, and I change the spread count to 3 times 2 equals 6. And now I delete the linear spread. I have set my I/O box with some values I can change and alter. When I would save this patch, VVVV would save these values for me. That's very, very handy. Okay, let's delete this. Okay, let's look at all the pins. I select an I/O box value advanced. Well, the slice count mode, I have handled that already. And you can toggle between input, calls rows pages, and maximum. Input just passes all the information. Calls rows pages let you set a fixed amount of slices in your spread. And maximum, that's a bit weird one. But if the slice count changes, the I/O box will always remember the highest or maximum slice count. That can be handy in some multi-touch purposes. Columns and rows, that's how many slices you want to see. So two columns and 3 rows means I want to see 9 slices. And depending on the slice count mode, VVVV will decide how many slices it will output for you. If I make it 6 and 1, I get 6 values out of my I/O box. But when I hover above the pin, it says 18, and that's because I have selected slice count mode maximum. So if I make this calls rows pages, I get 6 values. The pages count is to repeat how many times you want to have the columns and rows to occur. If I set my pages to 2, I will see 1 times 6 equals 6 values, but I will be outputting 12 values. Now, it's a bit weird, but the offset pin, that's here, slice offset, is located below. And here I can offset what I want to see in my I/O box. So now I got 6 times 2 equals 12 values, and I see only the first 6. If I do a slice offset of 3, I will see slice number 3 till 9. It can be handy. Okay, show slice index. Do we want to see the slice number inside the spread, yes or no? You don't see it here, so I select this one and I turn on the slice index pin. And here you see the slice numbers from the spread. Okay, the font and the font size. Well, this is just if you want one particular I/O box to stand out in your patch. So if I increase the font size, it is more easy to find this I/O box in the patch. Okay, show grid. That's used to see the individual slices. Make it a bit more distinct. As you can see in these types of I/O boxes, the grid is turned off. Here the grid is turned off and here it's turned on. So it can be really useful on a more abstract level. Okay, so far what I've handled will also go for the I/O box string and the I/O box color. You see we got slice count mode, calls rows pages, and the font size and the slice index and the grid. Okay, let's select this I/O box value again. Show value. Well, you can turn it on or off. When I turn it off, I only see the slice index. This might not look very useful, but over here, at these booleans, there's really no need to see 1 or a 0. Over here it's turned off, but if I turn on show value again, I right click. Now I see the values double, because I see the empty square and I see 0, 0, 0. And if I right click, I see 1 and a fill square. So it's kind of double to see the value and the button state, And besides that, turning show value on makes everything a bit more messy. Okay, show slider. Boxes and the lines inside these I/O boxes are called sliders. If you just want to show drive values, like here, then you turn off the show slider. But to create these other kinds of shapes, you want to turn the slider on. The next pin, show connections. Use this function to see the relation between the individual slices. Also, it's nice to keep track of the spread sequence when you have these types of I/O boxes. If I turn show connections off, I select it and turn show connections off, you need to guess what the first and the second slice is. So in this case, the show connections pin is very useful. Let me turn that back on. Show background. This is just another way to make your I/O box look different or to make it attract more attention. Turn it on. See here, nothing happens. But if I select this one and I turn show background on, it stands out even more. Okay, our sticky sliders. Well, this is kind of interesting. If you want a quick way to draw a graph, just turn it off. If you want to fiddle with separate slices, then turn it on. So if I select this I/O box because it contains sliders, you see sticky slider is turned on. Now if I right click on a value and I keep my right mouse button pressed, and then I drag up or down, I only affect the I/O box I initially clicked on. If I let my right mouse go, I set the value. Now if I turn off the sticky slider pin, do the same thing, I right click, drag up or down. The moment I hover above another slice, you'll see the mouse affects that slice. So this can be very useful if I just want to draw a quick graphical bar. Allow mouse offset. To demonstrate what this does, I will increase this slider and make it very big. Right now it's a 4x4, I make it 1x1 again. And scale it up to make it a bit more bigger. By default, when I right click on the slider, I can move it relative. Meaning if I just click on the slider and move up or down, the slider goes up or down. When I turn off allow mouse offset, and now I click inside the slider and wiggle a bit, the slider snaps to my mouse. So it's your decision if you want to use the mouse offset or not. Okay, let's move on to the minimum and maximum values. These values only apply on the manual input with sliding up or down. And by sliding, I mean right clicking and dragging. So if I make a new I/O box and I right click and drag, you see I can get it to any value I want to. But if I make the minimum to 0 and the maximum to 1, and I now right click and drag, I cannot get any higher than 1, or any lower than 0 for that matter. However, if I double click and type in a value, I can go beyond the maximum and minimum values. If I right click and drag again, it snaps back to the maximum. Also, if I attach a value here, so I make another I/O box value, connect them, and then I make this higher than 1, you will see the minimum and maximum doesn't really work here. If you want to stick a value between any minimum and maximum, you need a map. You need a map value node. This I will be handling in another tutorial. The minimum and maximum values are very useful for making sliders like this one. So you can slide between more meaningful values than minus 1000 and plus 1000. Well, there was a lot of information for one tutorial. In the next one, I will be looking at the slider alignment. And then you will find out how to make these cool looking I/O boxes.